To discuss the robustness of the 5G network and other issues, I would now like to call on stage Aruna Sundararajan, former Secretary of the Department of Telecommunications, Government of India, François Godement, Senior Advisor for Asia, Institut Montaigne, Gulshan Rai, former National Cybersecurity Coordinator, Government of India, and Kanav Monga, Managing Director, Virgo Group. The panel will be chaired by Rajesh Bansal, Senior Advisor, Carnegie India.
A very good morning, ladies and gentlemen. As for the last 1.5 days, you've been hearing about data and the future of data. But as we all know, that 5G technology can lead to real explosion of data, which the world has never seen. So this panel will first of all try and demystify 5G technology itself, and also look at some of the issues of 5G security, which are kind of clouding the debate in some ways. And we'll also try and, you know, touch upon the geopolitics of 5G with such a learned panel that we have. I'll start with, you know, Kanav, who is our technology and engineer and industrialist, to demystify 5G for us, and then we'll take it from there.
First of all, thank you very much to Carnegie for having organized this great 3-day session. It's been an eye-opener. And thanks, Rajesh, for the introduction. So 5G, I think it's a buzzword, but I think India per se is about, I think personally, a couple of years away from actual rollouts of 5G. I think as far as 5G is concerned, the fundamental game of 5G is data speeds. So we're going to have at least 10 times greater data speeds than 4G. In terms of low latency, it's going to be at least 10 times less response times in terms of uplinks on 5G. The other issue that 5G brings on the table is that as far as 4G is concerned, and the compute power that is there on the 4G network is primarily on the core network side. On 5G, what is going to happen is that the core computing is actually going to be brought onto the telecom towers itself, and it's going to be very, very close to the end user. And that is what's going to actually help low latency speeds. The other thing as far as 5G is concerned and a common user is concerned, there is going to be a tremendous greater experience as far as speeds on wireless devices or mobile phones are concerned. It will lead to newer use cases in terms of healthcare, e-education, and of course, in the US, to start with, it's going to be autonomous driving, I think, is going to be one of the big users. But looking at what really drove 4G into telecom networks and for users, it was practically the smartphone device. So I think in 5G, there is not going to be one single use case that is actually going to roll this out, but there's going to be a multiple set of use cases that will actually enable 5G and the need for faster speeds that are required. The other thing, actually, I think on 5G, what is going to happen is there's going to be a tremendous amount of usage of the spectrum. So there is going to be a network slicing, and common shared resources can be used by various telcos or service providers in terms of spectrum sharing, as they call it. It's going to bring in a higher amount of software development on the software-defined radio networks. And of course, the biggest issue is that, yes, it is going to present a tremendous amount of security issues. And I will leave that to Dr. Rai to answer the security challenges. And with that, I'll hand over.
No, thanks, Kanav. But because, you know, when we say about 5G, it's like a big bucket. Could you just tell us a little more about the various infrastructure components? Because before we move to the security discussion, so that then we can break the pieces and discuss in detail.
So if you look at 4G, what happened is that approximately every fourth telecom tower in India is connected to the what we call the core fiber access network. Not the core access, but the core fiber network. In 5G, to actually roll that out, you will actually need every single telecom tower to be connected to fiber. So you will need enhanced fiberization of the network. And then, for example, a hotel like the Leela will perhaps need at least 10 or 15 of small connected devices, which will actually be connected either to a Cat 6 cable or a indoor fiber network, which will then go in. So in terms of enhanced network capability, there will be a tremendous amount of capex required, both on the core infra plus on the access network. And the other thing that is going to happen is that if you look at the telecom towers today, it is primarily only you see a radio on these telecom towers. But in 5G, the telecom towers will actually have compute power, plus they will have storage as well. So there will be actual computing taking place on each of these telecom towers rather than everything going back into the base stations of the telecom infrastructure. So in terms of CapEx, if you are actually looking at India, you're going to be looking at least a $6-7 billion CapEx investment that the telcos will need to undertake to roll out 5G in the top 100 cities in India.
Thanks. Well, I'm coming to you. You've been Secretary DOT, Secretary Meti, and before going into security, you know, as somebody, as a to an ordinary user in this room, what do you think is the key use case? You know, as you mentioned, there are multiple use cases possible for a country like India, and then I'll come to François for Europe or other, you know, geographies. Is there an urgency, so to say, or how can it transform the way the digital India will develop?
So 5G basically has three fundamental capabilities which are inherent in that technology. One is that it's much faster and can carry much more data at high speed. The second is what they call low latency, and therefore you can have applications almost in real time, and this is fundamental for things like autonomous vehicles. And the third is that the density of devices which you can connect on the network increases exponentially. So out of these three capabilities, I think ultra low latency is something that may not be immediately relevant to India, because I don't think the, you know, low hanging fruit is really autonomous vehicles in India. But the other two capabilities, that we do want to carry more data faster, that I think, given the rate at which India is becoming a major consumer of data and contributor of data, because remember that the data revolution that we are seeing playing out is that people are also contributing content, they're just not consuming content. I think that's the way of the future. So both in terms of that, as well as IoT, IoT, I think, probably has the greatest potential for a country like India in terms of use cases, because it's expected that, you know, already we are beginning to see a fairly impressive rollout of IoT. You know, many of the operators are gearing up for big IoT. And given the fact that India's software capabilities are ideal for rollout of IoT, it's possible that IoT may really be our biggest use case, but we'll have to wait and see.
If I can supplement a question, which sector do you think IoT might have the maximum, you know, public policy impact?
See, we don't know how it will play out commercially, but if you look at it from a public policy and developmental perspective, then clearly agriculture, health, logistics, energy, environment, all these would be big use cases for IoT.
François, moving to you, you know, to get a perspective on how you've been working a lot on 5G and including security. And in this first round, talk about how Europe is looking at 5G in terms of deployment, in terms of use cases primarily. What is driving the deployment?
First of all, that has been considered. There has been financing, including from the European Commission, for a few years already. The problem is the scale. And if you look at the usage, I would draw on what you have said about deploying in 100 cities, because this is the debate. Are there going to be major centers connected to 5G, or is it going to be much wider, and the financial scale and the technical issues are completely different? To give you an example, telcos are constituencies for 5G because they don't want to be last to sell it. They would like to be first. So there is a stampede for the most efficient, cost-efficient, and fast system. But manufacturers, especially in countries where manufacturing, modern manufacturing, is dispersed, is not at huge metropolitan centers. Take a country like Germany, or take a country like Finland or Sweden, where it is very dispersed. They need a much wider network of 5G, so they are out front because the manufacturers are afraid in the Internet of Things not to be in the lead, and we have to consider the scale of investments elsewhere. A popular figure is what China is investing, anywhere between 180 and 200 billion dollars worth of investment currently, and almost no fees, or no fees actually, to a lot bandwidth, which means much more money available, of course, for telcos to deploy. So that is, it's a race in that sense. It's not necessarily a necessity for everybody. I personally don't see how much consumers, you know, the smartphone user will immediately benefit from 5G, but in other ways it's essential.
So we can just add to, you know, taking cue from what ma'am said about public policy. You meet with a lot of, you know, policymakers in the EU, let's say in Finland or Poland or Sweden. What are the key, you know, public policy considerations, or is it purely from a commercial telecom-led deployment point of view?
No, well, there are guidelines, and especially on the aspect of security, the EU has started to take the lead with an interim report, and now there's an EU Council resolution in the past few days on parameters for security. That's important. On the other hand, the telco scene in Europe is both competitive and broken by member state, with markets by member state, and with a huge number of telcos. By the way, that's how we got very low costs for phones, for mobile phones. We have very low subscription costs in most countries, but that also limits the amount of financing for future networks. So in that way, Europeans are in a bind. To the best of my knowledge, it's only three Northern European countries that have a plan for integrated cross-country 5G network, and the EU Council just pushed for across-member state coordination. But in that aspect, we are coming a bit late. As you know, all European resolutions start by looking like a train crash, and at some point, the action gets together, which is hopefully what is going to happen.
Thanks so much. So I think we have laid out the key, you know, elements of 5G, the infrastructure, and you know, possible use cases for developing world as well as, you know, European countries. Now coming to the key question that has been, you know, in some ways I would say colored the argument, and because of a lot of reasons, but we'll come to the right person, Dr. Gulshan Rai, who's a cybersecurity expert, was formerly the National Cybersecurity Coordinator. So could you lay out, you know, before we go into very specifics of security for India, what are the key security considerations being raised globally? And then you could talk to us a bit about what India is looking at.
Rajesh, I think the apart from security consideration, there are many other considerations with this technology. But I'll just supplement what my previous speakers have said, that panelists have said that. The first of all, the 5G is a paradigm shift in terms of technology standards over the past version of the your communication aspect, 2G, 3G, 4G. 5G is not strictly downward compatible. The way we implement 4G, 2G, 3G is not downward compatible. But that's not the end of it. What we are implementing right now in the entire world, including Europe or whatever China or somewhere has done, they have practically implemented a 4.5G kind of a scenario where the in technical parlor they say non-standalone kind of a architecture. Not a standalone architecture. Standalone is pure 5G. Non-standalone is where you put the 4G as well as 5G together, and if your existing instrument will access 4G and your new instrument will come to access 5G. That kind of a scenario which is getting implemented. There are about 36 countries right now have implemented the so-called 4G plus scenario. They have done it. Now, why this paradigm shift is there? Because we are dealing with 3.3 onward kind of a frequency spectrum. And as Kanav has said, that towers figure is said, is a by and large 1:20 kind of a towers figure comes up there. So the frequency range is totally different, starting from 3.3 gigahertz, 26 gigahertz from the backhaul, and then somewhere 80 above gigahertz in the rural area. So we are talking about an altogether different kind of a thing. That's one aspect. Second thing, we are talking about a internet kind of a protocol which is getting implemented there. So these technologies, the larger number of the towers there, and the towers also will be connected in a cloud environment, so-called the remote area network will be done there. Those towers will be, there will be in any network. For example, this part of the Bangalore, there will be another cloud. If you go to Indiranagar, there may be another cloud there. If you go to cross the Whitefield, there will be another cloud will be there. So that kind of a technology architecture will change there. The basic nature of technology architecture raises three issues there. And all the three issues have a technical implementation issues there, have a policy issue as well as security issues. One is the infrastructure, and which Kanav has said, that there is a fiberization is needed. Madam has said low latency and the high bandwidth there. You cannot achieve the low latency in the present kind of infrastructure because you get to take the fiber, the entire data has to flush out, and then you can achieve the low latency kind of a thing. You can achieve higher bandwidth only through that. So infrastructure is an issue, you have to take a fiber. The second issue is your regulations there, because entire frequency spectrum need to be regulated there. You have to see penetration, you have to see how the things happen there. And all of you know that the 26 or 28 gigahertz, the bandwidth there itself has gone to ITU regulation part of it. The India does not want the 26, 28 gigahertz band to use it because of there's different reasons there. So, I mean, that factor has come in there, backhaul factor has come in there. How the frequency will be regulated, that itself is a big challenge vis-a-vis the past regime there. The third factor, by virtue of your cloud, by virtue of internet protocol, and the fact that the heterogeneity, what madam has said, your vehicle, autonomous vehicle, your drones, your industrial automation, all will be heterogeneous element will run on the same network. And in between, kind of use one typical word, slicing of the network. So with this 5G, there will be a complete virtualization, which we'll achieve in the entire computers in the entire area. We already have a virtualization of the storage. We have virtualization of the computers. Now virtualization of the entire network will happen. Slicing of the network, virtualization network, containerization of the network, all those things will happen there. This will raise a lot of security issues, what we have been seeing in typical scenario of ICT there. Same, the data will remain either at the tower or data will remain either at your mobile system there. And the cloud will be remotely controlled there. So there will be a issue of the ransomware injection. There will be issue of denial of service aspect there. There is a issue of diverting the traffic. And I've seen some of the cases last year the internet traffic, the entire internet traffic was getting diverted for a few seconds to 10 hours or 12 hours, I have seen, to some country was going, and then all kind of issues I have seen. With this, AI will get implemented, ML will get implemented as a part of that because you have to control the remote area network. So the entire technology implementation will be very, very complex. The data theft can happen from the tower, data theft can happen from the mobile phone there. So, I mean, if you look at the recent case of NSO also there, what did the data that happened? Data theft happened from the mobile phone, not from anywhere else. It happened from here. So all those complications are going to take place in the 5G network. So regulation and the infrastructure and security, these are the three pillars of the entire issues which we need to address in the 5G.
Oh, sir, thanks for laying out the key critical issues for India to take it forward, including the spectrum issue. Could you tell us how the security issue, you know, detail a little more, how it changes in terms of 5G versus a 4G network? I know you have, you know, broadly talked about it. And because whatever, you know, a lot of literature says that IoT devices in some way. Yes, I mean, the latest issue about snooping and all that is a different matter. It could happen with, you know, any kind of technology. But how does that change when it comes to 5G? Because there is a lot of talk about at the edge, you know, a lot of compute will happen. And with IoT devices, It could be, you know, somebody is running a power grid to whatever else. And let's say in agriculture, or let's take a domestic scenario where, you know, if my wife wants to trouble me and I use IoT devices, by the time I get home, the temperature is 35 degrees, there's no water running, and there is no electricity, right? Various scenarios. So how does it play out specifically because of 5G? Let's put it like that.
No, I said that. You see, you said the word edge computing. I said the data will remain either at your mobile phone or the tower there. From there, it will flesh out. Whatever you're saying, back-end infrastructure, it will be largely a MIS work there. Who has done billing purposes, that kind of a scenario is going to be there. Now, if I can inject a malware software script right at your phone, it can impact your tower there, and I can take a complete control of the remote area network, the cloud part of it, and run it wherever I want to run it there. I may be making call to you or making call to her, but it may be going to someone else. The call may be there. I said that all the possible kind of a scenario which we are seeing in the ICT area will happen in this era also. Absolutely all. You can remotely control your devices. You can remotely shut down your devices. All this thing will happen. It depends upon what software script you implement and you inject to the mobile phone, get control of the tower, and get control of the things there. That's one aspect there. But the second aspect, which is largely geopolitical aspect, where the other countries are talking about, the entire thing will be monitored remotely. You have to put the patches, you have to update the patches, you have to update the software. How do you test out whether I'm sending a malware or I'm sending a genuine kind of a patch? That is a scenario which will create a threat to the national security. Mm-hmm. Because if you take over the entire system, I didn't mention the BGP, the net internet hijacking, which I have seen going on there, and I went to form post and pillar to see how things did that. So there are more chances over here in this system there. So there are geopolitical interests, and there are the interests within the country part of it. It is because of this reason. You see, if you look at the geopolitical aspect there.
Sir, you don't mind. I'll come to geopolitics, towards the end. Sorry to interrupt. But François, in Europe, a lot of countries are going ahead with this. And some of the security issues that we spoke about. How are those countries addressing those challenges? And as you briefly mentioned in your opening remarks about the recent EC, resolution, could you talk to us a little more about it, because that is like fresh off the farm.
It's a burning debate, clearly. It's been brought on both by the rise of Chinese suppliers, let's be frank about it, within the telco industry and beyond, by the way, because autonomous driving for several auto manufacturers in Europe is going to be achieved with Chinese suppliers. There is already one in France which is doing that, because if you look at high voltage pylons and transmission lines, today, China literally has a monopoly over 300,000 volts and is the only one that makes over 1 million volts. And one Chinese company, the one whose name starts with an H, is the supplier of software. So we are there with this debate. So rule number one for Europeans, European governments don't use the letter H. Nowhere, literally, in official text will you find it. This is non-discriminatory. We're looking at compliance with WTO rules and public market rules and so forth. Rule number two, more and more there is a distinction made between actual demonstrated security risks and how to mitigate them and the more general issue of trust. The main conclusion, in my view at least, of the very recent EU Council resolution lies in the following sentence: standardization and certifications are not enough to ensure security. The word missing, but the word that's implied in trust, and that obviously hits at the nature of the supplier, the links with the state, for example, and a number of related issues. So there we are in this in-between. Then you have the situation state by state. For some of them don't at all have the means for technical verification. I think this is a very big issue, that if you are in a smaller member state, how are you going to achieve that unless you cooperate and trust with others. The lead has been taken by the UK because it's got a long experience, and the report on security has come out on in the UK, although the government has not taken a final decision, it's hovering like other governments. But and then there is the US determination and pressure. In my view, the US determination and pressure haven't really helped. First of all, because it's a bit heavy. Second, because it's a bit contradictory. There's been a tweet, for example, that says that security concern could be exchanged against trade negotiation results. I don't think that's been validated or that's been kept in the picture right now. But of course, it sort of undermines the basic argument from the US. So to be frank, European governments don't want to be caught together on this issue. They want to show that they make their own determination. Then there is the issue of European suppliers. They exist for 5G. They actually have quite a high share of the market. They don't lobby publicly a hell of a lot, unlike the H company, which has been the biggest spender in Europe, but for a very good reason, because they're still suppliers in China. And they could hurt immediately their market prospects in China. I think on the whole, the analysis that the market prospects will decline, but I'd like the decline to be slow rather than fast. So we have an asymmetry in public representation about this. That's how I would start, you know, to present the situation. My gut feeling about this is that we are coming to a kind of common precautionary stand. It will not extend to supplies in third countries. So the telcos, for example, the biggest telcos in Europe are perfectly happy to take on any supplier in third countries outside the EU, but will become more constrained. German telcos, for example, have just delayed their choice. They have announced they would not choose now.
So ma'am, coming to you, you know, what should India be doing at the current stage on 5G? Should we, I mean, other than obviously spectrum issues and in some ways the financial health of, you know, the telcos is one aspect, but as a public policy person, I mean, where would you want to, what stance would you like to take? And I'll come to the geopolitics aspect later, but, you know, with all this debate globally, yeah, on security specifically.
I'll just step back a little bit, because I think, you know, globally, there are some common challenges around 5G, and then there are a set of concerns and challenges around India rolling out 5G. So globally, if we look at it, what we have to recognize is that, you know, 5G is actually a metaphor for a larger suite of technologies that are beginning to come together. So the what makes them so, you know, have so much of potential and therefore so much of promise for any country is because it's a platform, 5G is a platform for bringing together high performance communication and computing, because both these things are going hand in hand. So AI, cloud, etc. So what is happening is, on the one hand, the ecosystem is suddenly becoming hugely magnified. So if I were to take an analogy in this room, maybe today we have, let's say, 250 people with 250 connected smart devices, and maybe 5 years down the line, you would have three or four times that number, because everybody will be wearing a smart wearable device. There'll be many more connected Internet of Things and so on. So one, the ecosystem is suddenly hugely magnified. The second is that the capabilities, because of computing and communication coming together, it means that not just do you have large and many more data flows, but there's much more intelligence behind each data flow. So all this is going to, so this promise is also what makes this whole suite of technologies so vulnerable to threats, because it can be a powerful weapon for development, growth, progress, but it can also be an equally powerful weapon, you know, a cyberization, the weaponization of cyber. So this is a global issue that everybody is facing. And that's why we are also seeing that, you know, it's acquiring huge geopolitical undertones. So I would believe that when we look at the issue of security, we shouldn't limit it only to the issue of 5G and core versus, you know, edge, etc. It's a much larger issue we'll have to deal with. That's point number one. The second point is that globally use cases haven't really evolved yet, and we'll have to see on both sides how it evolves. The use cases on the cyber weaponization and the use cases on the cyber development. So that is something we'll have to keep track of. Now coming to India. India, I think, faces some specific challenges, which are that, you know, typically it takes about 6 to 8 years for any generation of technology to play out. So we started on our 3G rollout somewhere around 2013 in right earnest. So we are almost at the end of 3G. But in between, 4G came. And because we had, you know, the disruptive player coming in, we've quickly rolled out a 4G network. But I believe that in India, probably we are at least 3 to 4 years away from 5G. Because, not because the technology doesn't exist, I think, you know, the 4G network could be upgraded fairly quickly to 5G. But the fact is that the use cases, we haven't seen too much of evidence of use cases, so it's going to take longer. That's one challenge. The second challenge is what he was saying, you know, are we going to have islands of 5G implementation, namely the metros, or will we have wider 5G deployment which will be beneficial to rural communities, etc.? That's a key challenge that, you know, policy will actually play a big role in that. And the third thing is, you know, the security vulnerabilities, because India has, like every other country, has to evaluate its specific security risks in the context of its own unique geopolitical context. So from that point of view, we have certain sensitivities which will have to be factored in. I think that's one of the reasons why the Indian government is going fairly conservatively on the 5G rollout. But allied to that is another question. I think every country is trying to figure it out. What kind of domestic capabilities can we embed in these things so that we have more resilient network architectures? We are not overly dependent on one supplier. So all these questions will have to be addressed in India.
Thanks. So Dr. Rai, coming back to you on, you know, is it not possible that during transmission, you know, very specific things, like you said, compute on the edge, and you know, there could be snooping and rediverting of traffic. Do you think that application level security could address largely most of the concerns that have been expressed about infrastructure and 5G in terms of, you know, there is a British UK assessment which you could also talk about?
See, let me say that I said, and which she also endorsed, that lot much heterogeneity will come on the network there. That will come up. Devices, different devices with a different software are going to be attached on the network. They are going to be there. So the three issues which we need to consider, which may pose a challenge to us, and we decide we need to divide our technical structure as well as the applications or the any policy regulation looking to those things. One will be the breaches in the interface part of it, heterogeneous interface. Heterogeneous devices coming, there were different kind of interface there, and that's why I was going into the standards there, technical, which you said, geopolitics, I was not going geopolitics. So the interfaces, a breach in the interfaces or some vulnerability in the interfaces, that is going to be one of the most dangerous aspect here, because you are going to be a global network there. The second danger thing will be your the vulnerabilities in the hardware and software, which will get hooked, and they go the slicing of the network, of virtualization network, they will all part of it. So any vulnerability, that part. And the third most important thing is the challenge will come up, the processes and standards there. That's the most challenge will come up. This process, any vulnerability in the processes or any lack gap in the processes will itself introduce the vulnerabilities. Now, sitting from here, she said the wearable device, you can make a hell on the power grid by using those wide channel kind of a thing. And there are set examples I have seen, I mean, in my life, real examples I have seen in my life, how the things have happened. So I think we need to look at these aspects there and then devise our structure. The first most part is that, let me be candid there, India, she said 3 years or whatever period, I said that you may be implementing the entire 5G network in pockets in 3 years' time, but we will never be able to produce the entire 5G network, whatever we talk about it, in a matter of 3 years or 4 years. It may not be able to do that. In fact, if you look at the strategy there, European country or the US or Japan or elsewhere, minus China, they're all talking about 6G. They are not very keen, enthusiastic to implement 5G because they are far away from the technology development aspect there. So we need to stress more time in building the, creating the architecture so that they are resilient as well as secure and more trustful, what she said it. Second, we need to develop our own monitoring system so that we monitor the breaches both in terms of cybersecurity or any kind of a snooping which will happen. Certainly is going to happen, snooping is going to happen from the cyber point of view or from the intelligence point of view, and we have seen that. It will be very, very easy thing to do that. Third, how do you prevent a framework, the vendor supplying a breached kind of a system to you there, and he breaches from a, subsequently it may not be there, and the route was open. The danger is there because one of the country played a lead role in defining the standard. That's why I was coming over there. Standards. The whole thing is that you have an IP interface, the interface, but within, when you go beyond IP interface, input is IP, but if you go inside, is a proprietary interface there, with a proprietary kind of encryption, those kind of things are happening. So it is going to be very, very difficult to understand or notice or observe or test the breaches there. They are focusing more, NISA is more focusing on creating those test infrastructure. That's what German, and they are focusing, creating test infrastructure. I think those kind of a thing will be necessary, where we have an online kind of a testing or maybe offline testing or a monitoring of the thing, that is a priority for the country in terms of security to do that. With AI-led, if we focus on that, I think we will be able to check many of those things which everyone fears that 5G will come up, the security things will come up there.
So kind of on the standards aspect, do you think that India, from a technical standpoint, do we need to start working on standards that will work for India, or we should or lead the international standard setting? I mean, there are standards which 3GPP have already done, but let's say the, specifically the IoT level, you know, security standards, you have any views on it? And then I'll come to ma'am on India's capability and what could be done. Yeah.
So, you know, currently as India stands today, I don't think we have been very active in terms of the international standard setting of 5G is. And one country for sure has taken the lead in this, and they considered it one of their core agendas for the 13th five-year plan. So I think, yes, India, with the market size that we have and the number of connected devices expected to come on board in the near future, India for sure should get a seat on the high table of standard setting. I think the issue, as the rest of the panelists have mentioned, is that India is about 3 to 4 years away from a 5G rollout. Speaking from a telco's standpoint, I don't think they have the financial wherewithal at this point of time to really go in for a 5G rollout from any aspect. So I think India has time on the side, and for sure we should play a very, very big part, because apart from China, I think India is the only country that can provide the large market base that is needed for a significantly lower cost 5G rollout. And I don't think the European Union, for that matter, the US, Japan, or India can take on or where China is in terms of 5G standards. There is a very serious threat of a vendor lock-in, as Dr. I mentioned, and they've been working on that. You don't want to be in a situation where a telco which has 350 million subscribers in India gets into a situation where there is a vendor lock-in, and there are billions and billions of dollars invested in a telecom infrastructure to get there. So I think India has been very, very slow in terms of even deploying security standards within 4G networks as we stand today. Going into 5G, for sure, I think we have time on our side, and we should really be on the high table in due course.
Just as you give, just me a minute, I will add it. You see, There are two aspects of the 5G. One is the WAN network, wide area network, we call so-called mobile network, wherever the service provider comes up. The real aspect of the 5G will be within the premises, within the small business houses there. I think that will come up in fact, the 5G implementation, so-called Wi-Fi standard 6, Wi-Fi 6 version, which has come, is more 5G kind of a scenario there, which has already started getting implemented in the country. I mean, it's already going on. So all your 5G applications will get implemented much faster than you have a mobile 5G ready network. That's what I'm saying. So whether you talk about Intel, you talk about Qualcomm, or you talk about any other thing, they're ready in terms of the Wi-Fi access devices. They are ready in terms of the radios within the premises, and that will get implemented. Ultimately, that will drive the demand in the country.
Ma'am, you know, as India is, I mean, we know that 5G, if not today, tomorrow, and, you know, how many years it'll take. You know, as a country, you know, what China has already taken the lead in setting a lot of standards. What do you think we should be doing as a country for, you know, developing capabilities, and in what areas? To ensure that as and when 5G comes in, we are ready and are an important supplier of equipment to everything. Yeah.
So I'll just amend the question slightly, because apart from developing India's domestic capabilities for 5G, I think the larger roadmap for India would need to be around four steps. I think not just for India, for any major country where cybersecurity will play an increasingly important role, but even globally, the first thing is we have to move or encourage as much as possible open architectures. Because it's only at the architectural level that you can really address this problem. To reduce it to an issue of one technology, one supplier, one country, I think is not the real issue here. So we need to encourage movements like the ORAN, Open Radio Access Network Architecture, which is already beginning to evolve. India needs to join such global efforts to make sure that it remains as open as is possible, move away, therefore, from proprietary systems and commoditize them. The second step would be to ensure that supply chains remain diverse and that we do not, and multi-vendor driven, so that we don't have lock-ins. The third thing is to develop and embed indigenous capabilities. My own sense is that for 5G, it's a little late in the day for India, but not too late. Therefore, if a determined effort were to be made even now, I think enough indigenous capability exists for us to make a go of this. Fourth, that, you know, at the level of the standards setting bodies, 3GPP, etc., they are still in early days of work as far as security are concerned. Therefore, I think India, along with other countries, needs to step up its efforts much more. And lastly, I think certification and testing, that again, we do need to develop our indigenous capabilities. So I think what would be desirable in this area is, again, like data governance, if there were to be a more harmonized approach globally, because as he was pointing out, you know, we have an on-off kind of, you know, to and fro movement, where one supplier one day is seen to be banned, the next day not banned. So I think the global scenario continues to be a little fragmented, and we need to see much more harmonization there.
Thanks. So Ranzo, coming to you, you know, as ma'am said, it's kind of a swinging, you know, as somebody was giving an analogy, that states and countries are swinging from a yes, no, all the time. So how much do you think is technology, and how much do you think is geopolitics? Because there are NATO allies who are taking a stance one way or the other. So how does it play out?
I'll be very frank. I'm not a government person, so I can afford to to comment. If I look at the European situation, we have industry players. They don't have the scale required. Although they are big manufacturers, the stakes for 5G are huge. And we're not investing enough, either in Europe or the figure you mentioned in India, which means that the manufacturers from that other big country in Asia are going to have a huge domestic market, whatever happens, and then we'll have excess capacity. So waiting, as you've said, everybody can wait. We're all waiting to some extent or delaying decisions. That's not going to stop the problem, which will perhaps become even larger as these capacities have developed in the other country. So this is very important. Second, we forgot about industrial policy and support to innovation in Europe for a very long time. This is coming back, but the mechanisms are not yet fully there. The relevant companies, I'm sorry to say, don't belong to the larger member states, which means there is less constituency for support, actually, which is part of the picture. Third, we have an integration and interdependency in practice with American manufacturers, components, software, and so forth. A, that poses security problems as well, so certification and verification are indispensable, and probably a move to open source would be advisable, even if it raises its own issues. But second, it's very hard to envisage a situation that shuts out both that other big country in Asia and American, to be frank, suppliers, competitors. We have to choose. Politically, that's difficult. And that's the situation where we are in. I'm very interested, as you are, by the ORAN, the Open Radio Access Network solution, virtualization. I don't know if virtualization and clouds are part of the solution or part of the problem. We may find that they're also part of the problem. But it's hugely important because historically, the strengths on softwares have not been where the strengths on hardware are. And that's also an important economic aspect.
So, as you know, Dr. Rai and Madam, both of you worked in the government, and India historically has been non-aligned in a lot of ways. And for various things, you know, hardware to software, we move from Russia to the US, depending on what works best for us. In this, you know, and I can take the liberty of asking two of you because you're nowhere in the government, where does this, you know, Dr. Rai, where, you know, how much is geopolitics and our, you know, I'll be honest, China versus US, the trade interests, how much are they playing a role versus actual security considerations?
See, so far it was geopolitical because we are not ready and we have to get ready. Okay. And there are genuine concerns also there. But it is going to be a more technical kind of a scenario where the war is going to happen. If you see the standard, release 15 were out. The next version was to be out in September. There has been delayed. And so far, the standards have come up largely for the laptops as a mobile phone standard. But the standards for the all the devices, you call it drone, you call all kind of autonomous vehicles, those have yet to come up there. The real standard of the 5G has yet to come up there. The whether the European or the Americans or Japanese or everyone now has become active, including India too. I mean, to participate and play a definite role in creating those standards there. There was a tendency to create a more proprietiness, as I said, a good hybrid kind of a thing. They were trying to do that. I think that is now getting into technical debate. And the in my view, the technology will take over to the geopolitics to make it. Ultimately, it will not be possible for a long in the long period to restrict company A or company B or company C. It will not be possible. The world will be creating those kind of a standard, those kinds of mechanism to protect your own information, protect your system. It's a long way, but to summarize it, I think we are moving towards from geopolitics to a geopolitics towards a technology part of it there, rather than a trade kind of a business there. So far it was trade. Now we'll be moving to the part of the technology, real technology.
Yeah, ma'am. I know you'd say you've not been a diplomat, but you've been in the thick of things. So how much do you think, again, you know, this your view on geopolitics and our really strong trade ties with most of the suppliers, whether it's look east or look west, and the current dispensation of the US administration, you know, kind of indicating to its partners. So
my perspective is that, you know, digital technologies, of which 5G and AI, these will become increasingly foundational to you know, any country's economic and military power. And therefore, I foresee that it will get far more geopolitical in future. And we will definitely see these two poles, you know, I don't think India has the luxury of saying that, you know, we will develop our own technologies completely on our own, because you know that supply chains in the digital arena are scattered widely across, dispersed across geographies. So India will have to play this game intelligently, whereby its own capabilities and its market access can be leveraged so that we are able to secure a certain degree of resilience for ourselves. I don't think we can really hope for more than that. Maybe in the, if we start now, maybe, you know, half a decade or one decade from now in 6G or in some of these areas like AI, maybe we will have a little more capability to contribute globally. But right now, I think what we can do at best is to secure resilience.
So thank you. Before, you know, I would like, we have about 8 minutes left. Maybe we'll throw it open to audience and then come back to our panelists. Yeah. Sir, here. Yeah.
Very good on the panel. As madam told, how much government and private players think in terms of health sector and education to reach it 5G? How much time are is infrastructure ready on that, especially as priority with health and education?
Yeah, thank you. See, the Indian government set up a task force chaired by Professor Paul Raj from Stanford. So that committee, which had the Secretary, Department of Science and Technology, and Electronics and IT, has given a detailed roadmap. And in that detailed roadmap, health and education, along with agriculture, have been, and financial services. These are the four sectors that have been identified as key sectors for rollout of 5G.
Hello. I am P.S. Rao, working in Indian Defense as a senior scientist and director of unmanned air vehicle, artificial intelligence and robotics. This is regarding a military data security point. I will cite briefly two incidences. We had some Kargil war a decade back. The Pakistani intelligence people knew how many shells we are left with for the Bofors, very limited shells. So they started playing mischief on the top of the hill till we get exhausted with our shells. Then they started using machine guns from the top. All came up and we lost 750 lives. And the second one is Wing Commander Abhinandan recently took MiG aircraft instead of Mirage. Both the data, and they took YF-16. Both the ISI fellows came to know. And this was done by breach of security, not during Wi-Fi mode, it was on the communication line. We changed over in the first instance, we changed over from copper line to fiber optics, and the next one was working on C3I, C4I, command communication intelligence.
So sorry to interfere, could you please, because we have shortage of time, could you ask the question, please?
Okay, then the defense security, is it being, for India, we are users of C3I, C4I, huge, 5G is huge transmission of data. Are we taking up any special steps for this type of instances?
Thank you.
And one thing, Dr. Saab, unless I make it, it may not be clear. This was done by Stanford University, a cream by ISI. Those guys just split the thing with the prism.
Yes.
You know, the whole lot, and then they got the data. Thank you.
Yeah.
Let me just say in one line that whatever incident you referred, it was nothing to do with the cyber, okay? This was something else, something somewhere else there. You should be, you are aware and you will be know that. Now, this is a challenge, the security, this entire thing, that's what we were discussing, all of us were discussing. That's a great challenge and that is what we need to do. And I said, more than anything else, the priority as far as if I have to do with the country, my priority will be to set up a monitoring system so that I can check the vulnerabilities and check the data theft or any kind of intrusion into the network. That's what the priority will be there. And the government is working on that. You know, there is a National Cyber Coordination Center that is being upgraded now. Right now it's under the upgradation there. They to monitor certain aspect of the traffic there. No content goes there. Some traffic, some parameters of the traffic, intrusion, and that is through that we detected also that the internet traffic in the country from a company A in US to company B in India was getting diverted from few seconds to 10 hours there. That's what I said, mentioned there. So the capabilities are being developed, and I think it will get developed, and that's a priority for the country to do that.
The lady over there, yeah. Speak a little loudly. I don't know whether the mic is working. No, I think we'll then maybe go to somebody else, or you want to try again? This mic. Yeah.
Am I audible now?
Yeah. Please.
So I'm a software tester. I can foresee there will be many more opportunities for all our tester group with 5G emerging. So my question is, can 4G and 5G coexist? And the second part is, because it is not backward compatible, how complex it would be to replace or upgrade the existing systems which are running on 4G to 5G in terms of common people. My question is directed to Mr. Rai and Monga. Okay. Mr. Monga.
Maybe. Okay.
See, today the 4G, as I said, next there are two structures, non-standalone. The non-standalone architecture is 4G, 5G together there. 5G implementation in any way, in anywhere in the world, 36 countries have done it, is delayed by almost 1 year, minimum 1 year. So they're all implementing 4G plus kind of a thing, where 4G is there and some part of 5G is there. So this structure will continue for 2 years. That's one is happening. The second thing, side by side, one is happening, that instead of going 3.3 gigahertz or 26 gigahertz, now they are looking for a 700 gigahertz kind of a spectrum band. In some ASEAN countries, they started looking at it there. So the 4G, those evolution is taking place, but the entire 4G, together with 5G, will exist for a minimum of 2 years. Maybe more in India, but 2 years everywhere will exist. That is one very clear aspect is going to happen there. As far as implementing 5G along with the infrastructure of 4G, it's a challenge because 5G, as I said, is a complete paradigm shift. You have to add a 5G routers, you have to add a 5G entire antenna, smaller frequency range. But some of the infrastructure, which is a physical infrastructure, civil infrastructure, you can use it. So that way implementation will be better. Fiber, existing fiber will be better. Anyway, there is impetus in laying the more fiber. So the speed will come up, but there will be a challenge both in terms of infrastructure there.
So thanks, Kanav. Sorry, I'm not bringing you in because of time. Ma'am, you had a question here?
My question is to François. François, recently in a discussion we had about 5G, it turned out that Nokia and Ericsson have signed an MOU with a South Korean company. And there is a very advanced research center being set up in Finland, I believe, in Oslo, for looking at 6G. Do you see a possibility of international consortiums emerging, which could develop the advanced technologies without getting into geopolitical rivalries?
I think the problem and the solutions are both technological and financial. Suppose that Europe moves ahead more decisively in terms of the network. Suppose the US is doing the same. It's impossible with the existing suppliers to supply the demand. We need to build much more capacities. That requires financial cooperation. So I can see actors joining
perhaps takeovers at some moment. And there has to be a meeting of minds between component makers, software makers, and manufacturers. The example you cite is because Korea has been in the lead for 5G networks, and therefore is among the first to view the problem. But I think it goes beyond just two or three well-known brand name companies getting together. There is also the issue of how much the O-RAN solution might cut costs and therefore be a competitor. We don't know yet how that is going to turn out, but I think it's quite important.
Just to add, ma'am, even the Chinese companies also have an arrangement with Nokia and Qualcomm in certain components. I don't want to name here, but some of the components, even Chinese are dependent upon them.
So I just go around. The time is up, but 30 seconds. Sir, I'm sorry, you know, we can take it offline, please. Go around the table, you know, 30 seconds each. What is your, you know, 2030, where would you wish, you know, 5G or 6G, let's say, technologies would change the world? How would you want to see it?
So, you know, talking about 6G, I mean, we're still trying to figure out a use case for 5G. So I think 6G is just another buzzword. Perhaps next year Carnegie can take up a 6G conference. And that's for Rudy to consider. But I think it's just a buzzword. I think as far as India is concerned, what we've done in RCEP in terms of withdrawing, keeping in view that the domestic market is important. I think same in terms of 5G, keeping in view the security implications, we should seriously consider that. And I, once again, as far as 5G is concerned, I seriously think that India can play a very, very important role. Like you mentioned, the smaller countries in Europe are actually driving in terms of manufacturing 5G, countering China. I think if those countries see the market opportunity in India, this is a country that can actually really drive 5G use cases in times to come. Thanks.
So far, we have not defined 6G. I think nobody has defined what is going
to be
6G.
I mean, I was generally saying
2030, nobody has defined 6G.
Yeah.
We still have not understood, in fact, the world has not understood the real aspect of the 5G aspect also, but I can see very clearly that by 2030, India will have all part connection of the 5G, all application aspect will be there, and we'll have a better understanding to do that. That is the, by 2025, I believe 2025 will be the crucial time where the India will play India will start playing a serious efforts to set up the base manufacturing facilities in some aspect of the communication, maybe, or that may lead to 6G kind of a thing. So I see a greater future because our demand is more. We are looking little more progressive in kind of thing, taking time. But 2025, 2024, 2025 is the crucial period where we will be able to play a sizable role in the world.
Thank you. Wow.
I think the whole world has a lot at stake in ensuring that we have a secure 5G, because the biggest question on everybody's mind is that, you know, how do we really know that these networks are going to be secure? So hopefully there'll be much greater global convergence on how we ensure security in the 5G era.
Thanks. Anza?
Yeah, I agree that control of critical infrastructures in this case is paramount. I hope the hype over 5G tones down. India is not the only country where we also have to graduate from 3G to 4G in some areas. So, you know, let's not get completely excited. What I do hope very much is that ultra-low latency revolutionizes non-customer applications, things like hospitals, perhaps safer driving, and that's where we should really look up. Again, the interest for, you know, smartphone customers to graduate from 4G to 5G to me is less evident.
So we come to the end of this. Thank you so much, the illustrious panel, for a very engaging discussion. Thank you, audience. Thank you.